Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 14 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This one is special to me personally and has a lot of significance because this week we are joined by Kerry O'Shea Gorgone. Kerry is an intellectual property lawyer by trade. She was the subject matter expert on NBC Nightly News right after the Mayweather-Pacquiao fight and the intellectual property controversy surrounding that because people were using live stream apps like Periscope and Meerkat to live streamed the fight, whereas other people had paid upwards of $100 for the fight on pay-per-view. She currently works at Marketing Profs, where she hosts the Marketing Smarts podcast by Marketing Profs that myself and my co-author were actually on August 10th, 2016. We'll make sure to link that up in the show notes. She's also the Director of Product Strategy and Training for Marketing Profs. But before that, she was a teacher at my alma mater, Full Sail University. And Kerry really is like point zero for me in my marketing education journey because hers was the very first podcast I ever subscribed to. And via her podcast, I got turned on to Jay Baer, Dory Clark, Mark Schaefer. Like, she really is the genesis of a lot of the people that I follow online. So it's really special for me to host her on my podcast, especially after I've been on hers. So enough with the sentimental rambling. Let's get into our interview with Kerry O'Shea Gorgone. Kerry, thank you so much for taking the time.
Thanks for having me.
I just got to take a moment to publicly thank you in front of my tens of listeners for just the professional example that you've set and the impact that you've had on me as a young professional. In addition to contributing to the first chapter of our book, Beyond Buzzwords, which you guys can pick up at thinkbeyondbuzzwords.com, you were also the very first podcast I ever listened to. You were also the very first podcast I've ever been on. And no kidding, like literally about half of my Kindle Fire reading list comes directly from your podcast. Like, you introduced me to everybody. A lot of folks who have been on the show, Jason Falls, Mark Schaefer, Dory Clark, that all comes directly from you. So thank you so much.
Oh, that's nice of you to say. Happy I could help.
Absolutely. You are one of the few people that I can honestly say I've seen on the 6 o'clock news, and it wasn't a bad thing. Because, you know, typically, you know, if I recognize your face on the evening news, it's typically a mugshot or something. It's like, oh, man. But no, Kerry, yours was a good thing. Very good thing. So you didn't always start out as an expert witness on NBC Nightly News. And the road to, you know, the top of the mountain tends to be a winding one. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug? And how did you become enchanted with digital marketing?
Oh, brother. Well, I went to college in the era of the text-only web. I know this is difficult for you to imagine.
I know.
Yeah, we suffered. It was real. I went to college for business and got my MBA, and then I went to law school after that. So I started a career in marketing, then went to law school and practiced after I finished law school for a couple of years, actually for about 4 years. But just kept feeling like marketing kept calling me back. Like, I really enjoyed the creative side of it and everything. And I was thinking while practicing law that it would be so great if law firms would share little nuggets of information on a podcast to help people just kind of with the basics, not even the things most people would pay big bucks, right, to a law firm for, but just like get them thinking the right way about, say, estate planning or something. I'm like, you could totally do it. And, you know, it was like before there was content marketing, but lawyers at the time were not interested in giving away information for free. Right. So I pretty much stuck with, you know, giving feedback on like website design or doing what I could with video content and stuff like that. But anyway, that's while practicing law, like doing all these things on the side. So eventually I transitioned into teaching law, which I taught law at night and then worked during the day in college publications. I was managing editor of a magazine, the alumni magazine. at Bentley University, where I went. So it was pretty cool. And then I moved to Florida, and that was when I started teaching full time at Full Sail University. And I started teaching intellectual property and then moved over to teaching internet marketing because I had so much experience in marketing. I'd also had my own podcast and blog, and I'd done a lot of things in the digital space already. So there was a lot of that. And I don't know. I don't know if there was a moment at which I caught the bug, but my first podcast was actually about pregnancy. Because it was 2005 and I wanted to try podcasting, but I didn't know if I would like it. It was really hard at the time. So I figured if I did one about pregnancy, I could like stop whenever and, when I had the baby and be like, oh, podcast is done. But I liked it. So I kept doing that for several years. And I don't know, it's been a gradual process like everything else. And along the way, you acquire skills that you can use in any number of careers. And I think that's just been the case with me.
Awesome. No, just for the record, that is not the first podcast I listened to. I wasn't listening to the pregnancy one. I was listening to the Marketing Smarts one.
Oh, you want to know when I got involved in the Marketing Smarts podcast? Well, I was teaching at Full Sail, and I was having really awesome guests come and talk to the students, and I would moderate the discussion. So I think Chris Brogan and Mark Schaefer were two of the first people I had in. And I really enjoyed the exchange. Like I liked talking with them, picking their brain about things, getting them, you know, kind of like moving down this path of adding value for my students. And I was like, this is really interesting. I mentioned to Ann Hanley, who was a friend of mine, how much I enjoyed that experience, like conducting interviews. And I just mentioned to her offhand, we were going to lunch or something one day. And so a few months later, the person who was doing the Marketing Smarts podcast for Marketing Profs gave his notice that he was moving over to a different company, doing a different job. And she thought of me right away and had me in to do the podcast after that. And that's how I got the podcasting bug revitalized.
Yeah, and you got spirited away from Full Sail University before I could take your class. It was very sad. Very,
you ran
very
to me
sad.
So angry with me. I was like, who is this person? Angry at me.
No, like seriously, like I didn't have like a hero worship sort of thing or anything like that. But no, seriously, you were very apacho. I don't know if I'm apaco. I'm probably not pronouncing it right. But
I don't
like
know.
You were my, you were my foot in the door. You were to me what marijuana is to drug abuse. You were my gateway
wow.
drug, right? So it's like,
never
when
been
you
called marijuana before.
Yeah, you were my gateway drug. Like everybody on the professional landscape that I know of started on your podcast. So when you left, I'm like, of course you were still doing the podcast. I was like, no, she was my teacher. Now she's not anymore. But cool. So that's what's up. So when was the honeymoon over? When did things get real for you? When did you become disillusioned? Not necessarily, you know, disenchanted, but when did, you know, that shiny veneer sort of come off? And it's kind of like marriage, right? You're so in love at first. Everything's new and exciting. Then you find out that this person snores like a dying moose and has these other quirks. And, you know,
a word of advice, you still have to go home after this. So I would lay off.
Indeed,
lay off
the
misses. I
do. Indeed.
So I would say the first time at which I felt frustrated professionally was when I really wanted to do more with helping people who might need legal services to understand that law firms were here to help them, not just charge them a lot of money. There was this perception that it was impossibly expensive to get a lawyer to help you with things. But if you didn't have a lawyer to help you with, say, divorce or estate planning, you could end up paying a lot more money than you ever would have spent on a lawyer. And so thinking about it that way, I was surprised and kind of frustrated that lawyers or law firms at the time didn't see the value of providing some content for free, of teaching people, helping people. That's all very accepted practice now, right? Not mm-hmm. that everybody does it, but I think most people by now understand that that is a more effective approach. And that's what Jay Baer talks about. That's what Marcus Sheridan talks about, helping people rather than shilling. That's what CC and Ann talk about. But at the time, and specifically in law, they were just like kind of warming up to the idea of advertising generally. And to ask them to give anything away for free sounded like heresy.
Right. Very interesting perspective. So if you had a time machine and you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, we watch Doctor Who over here. What are the top three things you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
Help prepare specifically for my career, because I would definitely say you're right on with the sunblock. Keep applying that.
Right.
That's going to pay off.
Indeed.
I think I would just tell myself to be brave. I already was. I think the way that my marketing boss, when I called her after I'd been practicing law for a few years and I was going to transition back into marketing and teaching, she said, you know, most people would say, this is my bed. I made my bed. I'm going to lie in it. And you're going to go make a new bed. And, you know, she thought that was amazing. And that really encouraged me. So if I could say the same thing to myself, it would be, this will all make sense later. Like, don't worry so much about it now. Just make the moves that fulfill you professionally. And right. It will all make sense later, because I don't know how much time I get in this time travel scenario, but I don't think I'd have time to be like, invest in Facebook. You know, there's going to be this whole thing that happens. Like,
right. Well, what about in terms of like hard skills? Like me, for example, I wish I just took more time to learn how to code. Like I knew enough to code to pass the class, but like, I don't have any like legit coding skills in terms of, you know, it's just an all around good skill to have in the landscape.
For sure. I think this is tough for me because I'm not a big believer in regret. I believe things happen for a reason. You acquire the skills you have for a reason. I think if anything, I would just, you know, reassure my past self that all the skills I was picking up as an attorney, critical thinking, research, persuasion, communication, those are all things that are hugely valuable in really any profession. So I think I felt a little hemmed in at one point, like, this is it. I'm going to have to do litigation because this is where I am. Not necessarily true. There are lots and lots and lots of transferable skills. So, which I just was kind of like, I don't know if I was just too determined to change what I was doing to worry overly about it. But I think I would have just said, you know, it's going to work out okay. As far as hard skills I would have liked to pick up but didn't, I wish I had understood more about the web when it first became a thing. It sounds so stupid, but I remember at one point thinking I should register like weddingshoes.com or something, but it was $100.
Right.
I don't want to spend $100. That was really stupid.
Hey, hindsight's always 20/20. That's the reason for the question. And I really like what you said. Not a big believer in regret. Everything happens for a reason. I can definitely dig that. So we're going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Kerry O'Shea Gorgone. So stick with me. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry. This is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately, most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. And we're back. So, Kerry, you, Gary V, and Tim Ferriss, or, you know, insert whichever thought leader you're with if you're at a different conference. You're all chilling at the bar after the conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing landscape, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Wow, that sounds dangerously close to work for any conversation that's taking place at a bar. Especially right. With Gary Vee.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure that when he has his like secret wine party at South by Southwest, he doesn't do it so people can come and pick his brain about like the next big iteration of marketing. Yeah, I think it's all going to be about frictionless commerce and not just commerce for, you know, consumers buying goods and services, but even big B2B purchases, mobile is just so important. It's like, I hesitate even to call it mobile now. Now it's just doing stuff. It's how we live our lives. And it's just got to get easier in every industry, in every context, to do the things you want to do, even if those things are expensive, complex, multi-month deals. Like, it's got to be possible to get it done on a device that you can keep in your pocket.
Right.
So, I mean, that's, we'd probably be talking about the changing landscape. I don't think we'd focus exclusively on one thing like Snapchat or, you know, or even email, which is still here. I think it'd be more like how people are changing and how marketing and business need to keep up.
Absolutely. And that's very astute, because just in terms of search terms, people don't really use mobile as much as they did. Now it's connected living, connected devices, because you have, you know, these doorbells with video on it, so you can see who's at your front door. And you got these refrigerators that can tell you when to order more stuff. So it's, you know, it's still mobile technically, but it's connected living is starting to, you know, pick up in search terms, and people are starting to think about, you know, just being connected all the time. And it's, you know, it's Star Trek stuff. I'm excited. Like, I'm not looking forward to being beamed up, because I don't want my atoms scattered all over the, I'm like Dr. McCoy when it comes to that. Like, no, you are not doing that. Yep.
But I'm all good with the retinal scan. Like, scan my retina and let me buy stuff.
Yeah, I'm good with that. I'm good with the thumbprint. I'm good with everything. But when you're
maybe
talking
not
about,
like, blood, don't take blood from the vein like in Gattaca. That's a bit extreme.
Yeah, that's a little bit much. But
for stopping.
Yeah, as far as, like, being disassembled and reassembled.
I'll let like someone else try that first. Typically, I'm an early adopter, but when they start with that kind of technology, like transporter technology, I think I'll be like second gen. I'll second gen adopt that.
Third for me, third or fourth. That's scary.
Because you got to wait like a bit to see if anything bad happens to that first group of people that tries it. Just because they come through the other side and they seem pretty okay, like, they could be missing something important on the inside.
Very important. The neurons could have got scrambled. A lot can happen. So without getting political, but by all means, be candid. You know, candor is the whole point of the podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news backlash/crackdown on Facebook? Because immediately after the 2016 election, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played off the allegations like, oh, it's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the outcome. But then when the actual numbers came out, that in the last 3 months of the election, fake news did in fact outperform real news on Facebook. Now he's like, okay, we're going to roll out some sort of verification process. Like, where do you stand on that whole issue? Because, you know, me, I'm a Gemini, so I reserve the right to enlighten my opinion at a later date. But I isolate. I honestly don't know where I land. On some days, I'm straight First Amendment. Like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. They're a platform. That's it. But on the other hand, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, be it digital or terrestrial, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you're away on business and some knuckleheads, teenagers, hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool and one of them drowns. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. Doesn't matter. It happened on your property. You're responsible. So, like, where do you kind of fall on that whole spectrum?
Well, I think people have a responsibility to get their information from more than one source. Mm-hmm. I've harkened back to that advice from, he was my 7th grade social studies teacher, to get your facts from more than one source. Like, don't get them from one place. And that applies in every aspect of our lives. I think there is a dangerous lack of critical thinking that's happening across the board. And people are happy to be spoon-fed their information, you know, whenever it's convenient. If you're only getting your news from The Daily Show, which I love, by the way, but if you're only getting your news from The Daily Show, you're doing yourself a disservice, because there are other perspectives out there, and you want, ideally, an unbiased source of information that's almost impossible to get these days. But at least you should try to balance your perspective by looking at multiple sources. Now, as far as news sources, actual news media outlets, versus these, like, two guys in their mom's basement want to make some money with ads and wholesale fabricate really wild stuff, there should be a distinction. You should be able to tell the individual blogger just ranting or making things up, flat out making things up, versus a news site like, say, CNN or something that's supposed to be fact-checking and vetting. Now, whether they do it in every instance effectively is one thing, but they do have journalistic standards to which they are held, and there are consequences if they deviate from those standards. Whereas the individual bloggers can throw a logo on their site and say whatever the hell they want, and there's like zero accountability for it unless somebody decides to sue them for defamation. And what are you going to get? Like their hot plate?
Right.
Nothing. So you should give the people the information they need to distinguish between real news sources that have standards and professional requirements and other sources of information that you might still look at, right? But you deserve the choice. You deserve to make an informed choice about where to get your information.
That's an important distinction, the distinction between journalism and commentary. Like you said, on CNN, they're held to journalistic standards, which means that they're, it doesn't mean that they won't have a biased slant to it, because, you know, there's definitely a right slant on MSNBC and a left slant, or rather a left slant on MSNBC and a right slant on CNN. But at the end of the day, it still has to be factual, whereas commentary, to your point, you know, they can just say whatever the heck they want and, you know, consequences be damned. So, yeah.
There are people that made things up, completely made it up just to get clicks and raise ad revenue. So you, as the person on the other end of that, deserves to know that that's what's happening.
True story. But on the business side, and this is something that was discussed earlier when Facebook said that they were going to start showing you more of what you like. So there's kind of this feedback loop. Like, that's one of the things that makes Facebook attractive from an advertising perspective, because they can hone in so precisely on what people want to see. So I've heard an argument like, you know, Facebook's just giving people what they want. And that's another one I'm kind of on the fence about. It's like, yeah, it might be what you want, but that doesn't make it true. You know what I mean?
Well, people are being manipulated is the other thing. There was a lot of coverage after the election about how the Trump campaign hyper-targeted advertising content that played on the like psychological needs or emotional preferences of certain groups. And nobody else saw those ads, you know, outside of that echo chamber. They had a different type of messaging for each echo chamber. And it obviously was hugely effective, right? And it didn't cause these wide ripple effects, a lot of outrage publicly, because only a small subset of people saw each thing, and those people were the most receptive to it. So, I mean, that's just the reality we live in now. There is this technology, and I think people need to become aware of their triggers, their emotional triggers, and account for those to kind of counterbalance. And again, go get your information from another source. So you don't, it would be naive to say, don't act on the basis of advertising, because everybody does, right? Whether that advertising is content or, you know, a traditional targeted ad, but just at least make an effort to get out of your echo chamber and balance your perspective a little bit. You'll make better decisions.
True story. With these things, I don't know whether to be impressed or creeped out. It's kind of like that case study where Target figured out that this girl was pregnant before her father did.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
On the one hand, it's like, that's creepy as hell. But on the other hand, it's like, hats off to that data scientist. Give him an award.
Right.
Because that was brilliant. You know? And I think it... like you said, it's a brave new world. And now that president had been set, you can absolutely, you know, expect other politicians to do the same, because love them or hate them, it worked. So, it's one of those things. So
it would be disingenuous for a marketer to say, stop manipulating people.
Exactly. That's kind of what we do. But last question, and I'll let you get back to your day, and I greatly appreciate you taking the time. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his podcast, but I'm steering it in a very particular direction, and I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way I'm asking it.
Plus, say it, baby.
Every podcast, somebody's first cast. So in my personal opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at a brand or corporation or works at an agency. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship or solopreneurs, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. I'm talking about people with jobs, like people who get a W-2 or a 1099 at the end of the year. So just sort of using my own journey as an analog, you start off meandering the wilds of Google with varying degrees of success. You might land on lynda.com or marketingprofs.com. You might end up doing Amway, like who knows, right? That Google rabbit hole can sort of shake out either way. And at some point, you decide to get serious. And at that point, when you're ready to jump, you sort of have two options. The first is that you can do what I did, which is go back to school and get a degree in internet marketing. The cons to that is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my degree. Plus, it's time consuming. Even though the degree program is accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete, which is a long time in the digital space. But by far the more prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best in class practices is through conferences and seminars like Marketing Prof's annual B2B forum. The problem with that is that even though in aggregate it's a lot less than a degree program, you have to have that money up front. So depending on when you get your ticket with early bird pricing, you're looking at anywhere from, $500 on up. That doesn't include your flight, hotel, food, Uber. Once you add all those things back in, you could easily be looking at a couple grand.
There's a question in here somewhere. I feel it coming.
Yeah. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to crowdsource a way to professionalize oneself that doesn't include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to, come up a lot out of pocket for a conference. So the actual question is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, baby. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
The same way I did it the first time. think about it. So I've found not just thought leaders who were influential, but people who, for whatever reason, I felt I could connect with. Maybe that was their personality, their specific area of expertise, the way they approached their work, their life, that kind of thing. It's easier now than ever to get a sense of people personally, in addition to professionally, as long as they're not like, if they have this like super polished professional veneer, then you can't really, it's hard to see past that. Mm-hmm. Just online from my dorm room here. But other people are more genuine, more authentic. You could see what they're about. So I would gravitate again towards those kinds of people who I felt reflected my personal kind of approach to marketing, my approach, even my approach to life, right? So I'd feel like we could be buddies. We could sit in a bar and have a conversation about something. Those kinds of people are the kinds of people whose content I would go and check out and share liberally, maybe comment on it if I felt motivated, but definitely share it. And especially share it in groups where I thought that the perspective they had to add was needed. So I'd be looking at some LinkedIn professional groups around whatever it is I decided to do, because this is a new earth. I could really like do whatever. Then I would connect with those people who were both influential and interesting to me personally in my chosen field. I would connect to them on Twitter, start sharing their stuff, start conversations with them. Because it's very easy to do that. And if they continually see your name coming up and adding value to the conversation and sharing their content, they're going to get to know who you are pretty quickly. Like within 30 days, you could totally do it. I would also start a blog on whatever it is I decided I want to do in this new earth here. And I would have an email list associated with it because, I don't know, this earth, new earth, whatever earth, email and it is still, I think, the best tool for creating long-lasting relationships with people and adding value. Like I know Chris Brogan, I don't know about this new earth, but like back on my earth, he gets most of his income as a result of the email newsletter that he uses to promote his stuff, because it's not pure promotion. It's like promotion after he's given you a whole ton of really valuable stuff. So I think that's where I would start, if that makes sense.
I hope you guys were taking notes, because she dropped some value bombs, as JOD would say. And that magic word creeped in there, Twitter. I know a lot of people beat up on Twitter because the stock price isn't the best. But as a business tool, like, Twitter's my favorite social network, period. I've gotten a lot of interviews. I've gotten a lot of value out of Twitter. So, you know, Twitter is small but mighty. Kerry, this has been tremendous. I greatly appreciate your time. Please tell people where they can follow you on social media, how they can get a hold of you, if you have any products or courses coming out. Where can we get some more of you?
Well, I am at marketingprofs.com all the time. I develop their training programs and do their podcast every week, as you know. So that's marketingprofs.com. I'm also at my own website blogging about legal aspects of marketing at kerrygorgone.com. That's spelled like Kerry G or Gone. And I'm on all the social networks as Kerry Gorgone also. But thanks so much for having me. I really had fun talking with you.
I absolutely had a ball myself, and thank you for the time.
You bet.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.